God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your love. We thank you for all your grace. We thank you for all your power. You are the Almighty God, and we put the service in your hands. May you cover us with your Holy Spirit, and let us shout of glory to your name. Let us bless your name, and you will answer our prayer. Be present. Fill this space with your Holy Spirit, but specifically our heart. Dispose our heart, our soul, to worship you. Be with us, we pray. In Jesus' name, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
This morning's reading will be coming from Ephesians 2. Once you found it in your Bibles, Ephesians 2. And it will be verses 1 to 10. And I will ask for the reading of God's words that we all stand, please. Now this particular reading, I will be reading from King James, but if you wish to follow along in your Bibles provided in NIV, this is about salvation through grace. And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we had our conversation in times, passed in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, and hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might shew the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Amen. We give praise for the words of God. May we learn to live by them. Amen.
May the Lord bless you. So today it's a pleasure for me to proclaim the word of God, to share with you about faith, salvation. And I would like to, before anything, pray that God covers us with His Holy Spirit and give us exactly what He wants us to say for Him. Heavenly Father, we thank you for everything you have already done. We worship you for who you are. We praise your name. As we know our weakness, it is a privilege you gave us to speak, to stand and speak for you. But without your help, we cannot do nothing. We implore your grace and ask you in the name of Jesus, cover us with your Holy Spirit. Make available your hearts to listen and to understand what you want us to say. I don't want to talk as a human being, but I would like you to talk through me to your people in order to call their heart to a new consecration, new commitment to serve, new commitment to be living testimony for you. Father, we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, Brother Steve just read a portion of Holy Scriptures talking about faith, talking about salvation, grace, but also our conditions, how we were before we have done peace with Jesus Christ. We have been dead in our sins. And it's why I would like to consider with you another verse in Romans 4, verse 3 to 5. Abraham believed to God, and that has been imputed to him as righteousness. Those who do good work, they get their salary, not as a grace, because they have worked. And the one who does not good work, but who believes that he is justified by Jesus Christ, by faith, that is imputed to him for righteousness. When we put all together, we find the first thing, the more important thing, before believing is having faith. If you don't have faith, you cannot believe. If you don't have faith, you cannot make peace with Jesus Christ. They say there was a young man who knocked at the door of a servant of God. That man was hungry. He was tired and he did not have shelter because he was traveling. The man of God gave him a little note and said, just present that at the shelter, at the hotel, at the next corner. But the traveler did not believe. He remained in his condition of need. hungry and no shelter. It's the same for to rescue the natural man oppressed by the devil. God made a gift. It is the gift of faith. It's why people cannot have faith by yourself, because dead people cannot produce things. As the Bible says, we have been dead in our offense. No life. If there is no life, we cannot produce nothing. So, we should consider different things this morning. Why the faith cannot come from human beings? First of all, faith cannot come from a dead person. We have been dead in our offenses and our sins. We have been foolish, perverted. No one did good, even one. Those words express that the human being cannot have faith in himself. Faith is absolutely needed to turn toward God. The dead man is blind and deaf. Spiritually, the spiritual dead person is blind and deaf. When that person listens to the word of God, either in one ear and goes out in the other ear. Or it's like the water on a carpet, you know, which is not absorbing. The dead person cannot understand nothing in the will of God. He cannot understand the purpose of God. And the dead person considers the purpose of God as a foolish act. As dead, no sensitivity to the voice of God. All call God can do, he cannot react. No power to get himself free. Cannot get freedom. But a dead person needs someone to walk at him, to take him by hand and put him outside. There is no other alternative. Though the faith is a gift of God. Faith is a gift of God. Secondly, faith cannot come from a prisoner, because faith brings freedom. A prisoner cannot free himself. There is someone who might declare you supposed to be free. There is someone who may act in favor of that person, or even for evasion. He cannot go by himself, do all things by himself, because there is someone who has helped him to be out. In Isaiah 42, verse 6 and 7, he said, "I, Lord, I call you for righteousness. I take you by the hand. I protect you. I establish you for my covenant with the nations, to be the light of the nations, to open the eyes of the blind people, and to put out the prisoners from the who eaten captive from shadows. The prisoner cannot make himself free. Regarding this text, the human being is condemned to remain in prison, in jail, until someone come and take it outside the prison. Any prisoner is not enough clever, strong to go out of prison by himself. There is someone who has to help him. It's the same thing. The devil remains us captive from sins. The world wants to take us in his prison. And we cannot be liberated from the world unless God take us by the hand and put us outside. Third thing, what is the purpose of the gift of faith? The gift of faith is the capacity, the skill God put in us by His Holy Spirit to listen to the call of His grace and to respond to that call as a sinner. In Ezekiel 36, verse 26-27, God declared, I will give you a new heart and I will put a new spirit in you. I will take off your flesh the heart of stone, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you, and I will make you follow my instructions, my sentences, my ordinances. God decided to transform the dead person in a living person. At the beginning, God created a form of human with the dust of the earth, and He put His life in, and that became a living being. But in Eden, man has been so foolish to disobey to God, and then they lose this capacity. And then God took a plan to restore human being. It's why He said, I will. Everything is at the future. Future things. I will. I will. I will put. I will give. I will change. I will transform you because you have lost what you had in the beginning. If there was not the grace of God, we should be only people with heart of stone. No sensitivity to the call of God. Dead regarding the relationship with God. God has only one remedy, one medication for us. Take out the heart of stone and put a flesh of stone. In the heart of flesh, there is sensitivity. In the heart of flesh, there is emotion. We become like we have been before the disobedience, because now, with the flesh, with the heart of flesh, we can listen to the voice of God. we can follow the ordinances, we can follow the will of God, we can follow the institutions of Jesus Christ. This operation is a big surgery. This operation is a big surgery to change the heart of stone and to put a heart of flesh. And that cannot be done only by the Holy Spirit. Only by the Holy Spirit. It's why we say, the Bible says, faith comes from what we heard. And what we heard comes from the word of God. Because when you expose yourself to the word of God, the Holy Spirit comes and make you understand the word. And when you understand the word, your faith increases. When you understand the word, you become a living person. When that happens in you, people, you amaze people. People do not understand how you live. How? In time you should be in tears, you are laughing. Because there is another power inside you. It's the Holy Spirit power. When you expose yourself to the word of God, your destiny changes. When you expose yourself to the word of God, your objective change. When you expose yourself to the word of God, your faith leads you to act another way. People may say, he's a foolish, always talking about God. But they don't know what kind of power working in you, it makes you attached to God. They say there was a young man who went to a nun of Buddha, of Buddhism, and asked him, he wants to be saved. The monk take him to a river and make him enter the river and push his head down the river. And the young man fight to breath until the monk give him a break. And he said, what did you, and the monk asked him, what did you want? He said, I want you to be saved. Say, when you were under the water, what did you need more to live? Say, air. I need it. Say, okay. As you fight to find air to breathe, when you will be saved, you will find the same way to get life. That this I would like to see with you for finishing the dimensions of faith. I would say that faith is like a diamond piece who has four faces. As faith comes from what we listen to, what we hear, and what we hear comes from the word of God. Faith is stamped on a database. Faith is stamped on a database. You cannot believe if you don't listen to something and believe what you have listened to. You understand what I mean? You, for example, someone talk about education. Until you see that person who has the problem and that use that medication and become okay, you cannot believe that medication is. You agree with me?
All right.
So the first sight, the first phase of faith is knowledge. You cannot have faith if you don't know. You cannot know if someone doesn't tell you.
If someone doesn't tell you, you will never know. Because you are not born with the knowledge in you because of sins. Nobody will stand up unless it's foolish at extra limit. We'll stand at 50 feet and put it and fall down in the deep space. No. Many people, it's why faith supposed to stand on a solid thing, what you have heard, what you have seen. There is no faith without a minimum of knowledge. No faith without a minimum of knowledge. So, we can say, what is the first phase of faith?
Knowledge.
You know what you buy. You know why you buy it. You know what you're looking for. You know why you are looking for. Right? The second dimension of faith is belief. The second dimension of faith is belief. He said, if you believe in your heart God has raised him from death, you will be saved. In this dimension, we can say knowledge and belief, they go together. Knowledge and belief, they go together. Belief cannot exist without knowledge. And it's evident. To pass from knowledge to belief, you go ahead one step. We may understand that if we consider knowledge or belief, only concern the domain of the cognitive domain of law of human being. Faith is the faith knowledge accepts the truth of the scriptures, and the faith belief state that they are certain. Worthy to believe the truth that the Bible revealed to human beings. That means the second phase of faith is belief. I get knowledge, now I start to believe. I get knowledge of Jesus Christ, now I am in a fight, I am in a duality. I have two thoughts. Is it right? Let me go forward to see. Because I start getting knowledge. And I am on the first step of my faith. The first step of my faith is doubt. I doubt. Is it true what he says? Let me dig. Let me dig a little bit more. Now you are at the first step. You get knowledge. Knowledge being doubt. But they used to say. But he said. Let me dig a little bit. The knowledge bring you transfer from knowledge. You go step by step. You go through doubt. And you get belief. You get belief. And knowledge and belief leads you to increase your faith. To get the third dimension, there is confidence. When you get knowledge, you believe, you become confident. Because when you get knowledge, you start to appreciate. When you appreciate, you say your preference. When you say your preference, you develop like, you develop love.
Love win confidence. Right?
So the what is the first dimension of faith?
Knowledge.
The second one?
Belief.
The third one?
Confidence.
Confident. When you believe, you become confident. When you love someone, even you feel that person is lying, you still remain confident. Right? Right?
Yeah.
When you get knowledge, knowledge brings you to believe. You get victory over doubt. That means you believe. When you believe, you become confident. Because I believe that is the right way. That is sane. That is the way. That is the good one. This is, you know, because you become confident. To define faith, Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, it is the substance of what you're looking for. The Greek used hypostasis. That means support, sustain, firmly, insurance. The personal faith is that absolute insurance of the sinner, counting on the faithfulness of God, believe in his promise to justify in Christ, the one who believe in Christ, the one who believe, you accept Jesus Christ as his Savior and Lord. Faith, confidence, does of Jesus Christ, make of Jesus Christ the object of our faith, and our faith stand only on Jesus Christ on the base of the salvation. When we believe in someone, we believe because of the proof. The person gives proof. Okay, someone tell you, I buy a Rolls Royce for $10. You say, it is not possible, I don't believe you. He take a receipt, he say, yes, this is it. I paid $10 for this. Now you have the proof, you believe. You agree with me? This person say, I buy this house for $100. Are you lying? You cannot buy a house for $100. He take you to the paper, you see, okay? And he made 50 cents as mortgage. Now you have the proof, you believe. Even if it look impossible, you go over the doubt, you get the belief, you get the proof, now you believe, you are confident. And as confident, you say, you're right. You confess, he's right. What is the third phase of
confidence?
Confidence. The last one, the fourth one, the fourth dimension of faith is obedience. The fourth one is obedience. First,
knowledge.
Second,
belief.
Third,
confidence.
Fourth,
obedience.
When you love, when you are confident and living in love, you are very obedient. Right? Hello?
Yes.
You are very obedient. It's the same thing spiritually. When you get that knowledge of Jesus Christ, you believe in Jesus Christ, you become confident because anytime you pray, God answers. And when you become so confident, you say, no, I will not treat my God. No, I will not be disobedient to my God.
No, my God, God, you have done so many things for me. I will obey to the word of God and you become obedient.
Yes. Yes.
And when you are obedient, your faith keeps increasing because God paid the obedience. God rewards obedience. It's not enough only to get knowledge about the way Jesus Christ born, his life, his death, his resurrection. But is more important, obedience to the word of God. And my question today, you know your life better than anyone. You know everything about you and God, and you know God knows about you. How are you obedient to the word of God? How are you obedient to the Holy Scriptures? How is your life regarding God's instructions, God's instructions, God's recommendations? You believe God exists. Yes, the devil, Satan, the devil, knows God exists also, but tremble. It is not a superficial belief. God is taking care about deep belief. The belief will lead to confidence and obedience. You cannot be obedient when you say, oh God, you know, the flesh is weak. That is not belief. Oh, God, you say that too, but you know, I cannot accept that from me. You are not obedient to the word of God. Because you say, love your enemy. Oh God, it's who you say to forgive, but you know what brother, sister, such person says or do, I cannot forgive him. You are not obedient. Because God says your capacity to forgive is the dimension of your love. How do you feel this morning? How do you see your faith in God? Do you have enough knowledge that brings you belief and belief to confidence, confidence to be obedient? How do you feel this morning? Your obedience to the word of God. God says, I like obedience, I hate sacrifices. God doesn't need you to come to church every Sunday just for coming to church. He wants you to be obedient to his word. God is calling you this morning to be an obedient person. To believe in the word. To do not look for any other resources, only the scriptures and his resources. You know, all gold, all silver is for God. Do not look for them outside God. Do not look into your flesh, because the desire of the flesh lead to death. Look for the desire of the spirit, because the desire of the spirit are opponent to the desire of the flesh. The spirit want to take you to God. The flesh want to take you to the devil, to the hell. Are you obedient to the word of God? If you feel if you feel that you need prayer, I will ask you to come ahead. I will be pleased to pray for you, in order that God, the Holy God, can put His Holy Spirit in you to bring you to that faith with His four faces, knowledge of God by the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we come to you with so much to thank you for. As your children, we want to shout out for joy and sing your praises for all you have done for us. Thank you for this moment when we withdraw from the world's pressures and anxieties into a quiet place where the sun is shining and the green trees. In this place, Father, are bending against the blue skies. The flowers are blossomed, the grass is green, the water is clean. There is a fresh fragrance in the air, and we sense your presence over our God, who loves us, and peace is filling our life now. Father, give us now the courage to step into life with new drive and motivation. Help us to channel the creative ideas you give us into beautiful life. Give us the strength to hold on to hope as we meet the many challenges throughout the entire week in coming. Lord, give us love as we share with others all the things we have, all the things you have given, and everything you have done in our life. We may say with integrity to those we meet, God loves you, and so we do. Father, we put every person in the church in your hand for the entire week in coming. May you pour your blessing upon them, strengthen, enlighten them by your Holy Spirit, and let them live, each one may live as a living testimony for you, at home, at the work, in the street, anywhere. We implore your grace upon Oshad family, where they are actually. May you cover them with the blood of Jesus. The sick person between us, may you put your blessing hands upon him to heal them and bring joy, hope. May the people facing challenges be restored and the challenge resolved. May your grace fill us, your Holy Spirit fill us, and your goodness abundant in us. Father, we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.